Okay, so today we'll be talking about your cells and organs of mucosal system in the series of immunology. So what we will talking about in the previous lecture, what we had done is to tell you what are hematopoietic stem cells, how they are replenishing everything. So based on that scenario, we'll be taking this lecture ahead. So what you will be understanding in this particular lecture, let me give you a brief that what you will be doing, what we will be actually discussing. Just give me a sec. Let me allow this particular scenario. Yeah. So what we'll be doing in this section, we will be talking about other type of cells that are formed from hematopoietic stem cell. Yesterday what we did, we had a narration regarding the neutrophils. We understood that how they are going for the suicide part and how they are forming the beneficial suicide mediated net in order to clear the pathogen. So today what we'll be talking about, we'll be talking about the other type of cells other than the neutrophils. First we will be talking about the myeloid lineage, and next we'll be talking about the lymphoid lineage. So this lecture will be based on providing you the clear cut understanding of the scenario, and also to help you understand that when we are talking about the components of immune system, when we had understood it clearly that how they are being replenished by hematopoietic stem cell, then in brief you should also be aware before going ahead in this series that what are these cells and what in brief the function what they are performing. So first of all, we are talking about the basophil. Now if you see this image, it's a zoom image, so it's very clear that it contains granules, and this is darkly stained is nucleus. So yesterday when I showed you the image of neutrophil, or in the previous lecture when we discussed about the neutrophils, so in that also we said that it is almost about 45 to 50% of the WBCs, but these basophils are present in very less quantity, and it's around less than 1% of the total leukocyte contents or the total WBC. What else? See, these are not phagocytic cells. They are not involved in phagocytosis. In fact, basophil cells are responsible for mounting the allergic response. In response to any allergen, if a patient is developing allergic reaction, the cells which will be increasing in number and will be performing its function are called as basophils. Are called as basophils. How they are doing? See what they do. They will bind to the antibody. Suppose a foreign particle has entered, which is an allergen. The particle has entered in the blood. Our antibodies will be binding to the particle. Now, once this allergen antibody complex is formed, then these basophils will be coming and they will be binding to the antibody. What type of antibody? Antibody which is bound to the allergen, not to the free antibodies. No, they will never bound to the free antibodies. They will bind to the antibodies which are associated with the allergen. After recognizing that yes, allergen antibody complex is there, they will release these granules. What are these granules? These granules are histamines. Histamines, which you might be understanding that they are released from the mast cell. So if you stain the cells, you will see that these orange colors molecules are being released, and these are called as mast cells or histamines that are being released. Now what is the function of histamine? Histamine, what it will be doing, it will increase the permeability of your blood vessel. What do you mean by increasing the permeability? Like we had understood the concept of neutrophil, where the chemokines and all the granules were increasing the vascular permeability, these basophils are also responsible for increasing the permeability. Fine. So in short, hum kya baat kar rahe hain in short what we are talking about. In short, I am saying कि ये जो basophil cells हैं, ये आपके allergic reactions के अंदर काम आते हैं. They are involved in allergic reactions. Fine. Then next part. Let's move on to the next phase. What is next phase? Next are eosinophils. Eosinophils. Now, what are eosinophils? These are again the cells of the same lineage. The lineage which we were discussing in the previous lecture, the myeloid lineage. If you see the image, it's very simple that you are seeing two big structures. So it's a bilobe. It's not multi-lobe nuclei. It contains only two lobes. I'm not saying it's a two nuclei. It's a single nuclei, which is bilobed, which is bilobed, fine. And these eosinophils are responsible for fighting against parasitic infections. Worms. Common notion, there is a common notion that yes, you might be having worms in your stomach, which is giving you different symptoms. So in that parasitic infection, suppose a nematode has entered or any worm kind of structure has entered. So what these eosinophils will be doing? See, once the worm has entered inside the body, the antibodies will be binding to different portions of the worm. Once the antibody is bound, then these eosinophils will come and bind to the antibody. Now what they are doing? They are recognizing the antibody which is attached to the worm or the parasite. Now after attaching, they will release the granules. They will release these granules. Now once they release the granules, granules will be distributed all over the parasite and they will start forming the pores on the parasite. They will start forming holes on the parasite, thereby causing death of the parasite or killing of the parasite. And when we go to the doctor and doctor says that yes, in your blood count, let me see the cell. So if neutrophil is higher, that means you are having a kind of a bacterial or pathogenic infection. Yes, because that are the first site, that those are the first cells that are recruited. If your eosinophil is higher, that means it's a parasitic infection. If your basophil is higher, that means you are having allergy. So that is how the blood count helps us in deciphering what exactly is happening inside the body. And that is the reason why doctors go for the elimination of these cells in the blood count. So let us summarize the three cells that we have studied. First is neutrophil. When we are talking about the neutrophil, right? So neutrophil is nothing but a big cell that we had discussed involved in different functions, whether it is vasodilation, whether it is inflammation or sort of things. And when we are talking about eosinophil, yes, it's important for worm infection, parasitic infection, for mounting response against parasites. Basophils or mast cells or basophils are the same because they are releasing the histamine, which is important in mounting response against allergy. So these are the three components that we had discussed. Now let us go ahead and let us understand the other parts. Other parts of the myeloid lineage, we are looking at the scenario. See, apart from granulocytes, there are agranulocytes also, right? Agranulocytes, the cells which are not having any granules. Those cells are monocytes and dendritic cells. You have to understand that these monocytes are formed from the progenitor cells, and then these monocytes will be circulating inside the blood. They will reach to the tissue, and the tissue they will differentiate into form macrophages. So these cells, all these three cells, are phagocytic cells. Dendritic cells are also phagocytic cells. What they do, they simply, phagocytosis means ingesting a pathogen, processing it, digesting it, and clearing it. Apart from this phagocytic thing, what these cells are doing, what macrophages and dendritic cell is doing? See, these cells are the link, cross-link between humoral and cell-mediated immunity. In previous lectures, I clearly told you that there are antigen-presenting cells. What they do? They take up the pathogen, they process it, and then they present the antigen via MHC molecule on the surface. So these cells are called as antigen-presenting cells. So there are three types of antigen-presenting cells: macrophage, dendritic cell, and the last other type what we are talking about is B cell. Although we are not considering that in this particular lineage, but B cells are also there, which are presenting antigen-presenting cells. So that is their function, is to clear the pathogen and also to activate the cell-mediated immune response. So when we are talking about the development from hematopoietic stem cell, how the phagocyte, how the macrophages are coming. See, the myeloid progenitor cell will be forming monocyte. This monocyte will be circulating in the blood. The moment it reaches to a tissue, then it is called as your phagocyte, macrophages. So, what is monocyte? If you stain the monocyte which is present in the blood, it will give you this kind of appearance. It contains a single bean-shaped nucleus. There is no lobe. It gives you an appearance of bean, the Rajma bean shape of appearance that you'll be seeing. It remains in the blood for 8 hours, and during that period, it reaches to this stained tissue. Okay. Then, when we are talking about the tissue, we talk about the macrophage. So, monocyte and macrophage cells are same. You have to understand that the cell, when it is present inside the blood, we call it as monophage or monocyte, and when it reaches to the tissue, we call it as macrophage. And that is the mature part. So, what it becomes? Once it reaches the tissue, the small cell now becomes the large cell. It contains different organelles, and it is now an active phagocytic cell. So, what it does, apart from digesting the antigen, what it does? It will also present the antigen on the surface, and based on its tissue type, we name it by different names, and that we had already discussed. Then let us talk about the favorite part, that is dendritic cell. This is perhaps my favorite type of cell in the immunology. Based on these cells, there are multiple therapies that are designed right now. The dendritic cell therapy, the immunotherapy, which we are talking about in terms of anti-cancer regimen. So why we are talking about dendritic cell? First of all, when we discuss the development from hematopoietic stem cell, you see here, they can be generated by myeloid also, and they can be generated by lymphoid also. And because they are very important in terms of presenting the antigen and activating the T cells, activating the cell-mediated immunity. So that's why they are very deeply investigated, and their discovery was awarded with the Nobel Prize in 2011, when people actually realized the potential of dendritic cells, right? So what they are doing? Whenever we are talking about the cells which are major antigen-presenting cells, out of the three, macrophages, dendritic cell, and B cells, dendritic cells are the major antigen-presenting cell. Now, what do you mean by this statement? Suppose a pathogen has entered inside the intestine, intestinal infection is there. These dendritic cells will be sensing it, and they will be reaching there faster than any type of cell, faster than any type of cells. They will be taking up the antigen quickly, and they will start processing it. Now, where they have gone? They have gone to the intestinal portion where the site of infection is there. They will take the antigen, and along with the antigen, they will travel to the lymph nodes. There are different lymph nodes, or you can say secondary lymphoid organs that are there in our body. So they will take the antigen in that lymphoid organ, they will process it and present it to the T cells. Now, what is happening? T cells do not require to move anywhere else. They are residing in secondary lymphoid organ, and dendritic cell is responsible for stimulating it. So what it is doing? It is providing the exposure of antigen to the T cells so that a quick response can be initiated. And that is the reason why dendritic cell is used as a module for therapy, because they have the potential to highly activate specific type of T cells. Now, when I am talking about dendritic cell, the dendritic cell which takes the antigen, which captures the antigen, is immature dendritic cell. When it reaches to the secondary lymphoid organ and presents the antigen, then it is called as your mature dendritic cell. And this is how that our dendritic cell appears. This is how our dendritic cell appears. You can see there is multiple extensions, right, from the base body. That is the reason why the name came, dendritic cell. So it's a kind of a cell which has its unique structure, which is very potent antigen presenter and phagocytic cell. And it can be made from both the lineages. That's why our body is highly dependent on these cells, that is dendritic cells. And when you stain it, it will give you this kind of structure in real time scenario. You can clearly see the appearance of the dendritic cells, the extensions and the different morphologies what they are taking. And when we are talking about other cells in the myeloid lineage, platelets, the blood, our blood is made up of what? All these WBCs and what we are talking about, leukocytes, granulocytes, and RBCs and platelets. So platelets are formed from a common progenitor cell that is called as megakaryocyte. Now the word itself is showing you mega, that means the size is very higher. Karyocyte, that means we are talking about the nucleus. Okay, so this particular cell will be responsible for forming multiple type of platelets, So whenever we say, suppose our infection has happened, dengue fever has occurred, it reduces the platelets, and then supplements are given in order to reconstitute the platelet content. So how our body is replenishing that platelet? Our body will signal the hematopoietic stem cell. Hematopoietic stem cell will form myeloid progenitor. Myeloid progenitor will direct to differentiate into a megakaryocyte. And the higher the number of megakaryocyte, higher will be the number of platelets. So when you see, when a person is examining that whether the platelet count has increased, they can directly look to the megakaryocyte. If the megakaryocyte has started appearing, the number is increasing gradually, or it's increasing very handsomely, then you may say that yes, this patient will recover in near future. And that is how we enumerate, and that is how platelet works. See, this is a real-time image of the platelet. I just took out for your sake. And when we say that blood is clotting, what these platelets are doing? They will secrete different protein. They will secrete a fibrin protein, which will clot this particular portion. Let me showcase here. So these red are RBCs. These red are RBCs, and this fibrinogen molecule will clot and immobilize the part where it is, where the leakages have happened. And last is RBCs. How red blood cells are formed? How red blood cells are formed? They are formed from erythroid progenitor cells. And let us see how an RBC, how an RBC is looking. When you take out the blood, you stain it, and you will see that there is no nucleus in these cells. That means the RBCs, mature RBCs of human and mouse, they don't have any nucleus. But is it the same for other species in evolution? The answer is no. Okay, so it's not the same scenario that we are talking about. Then let us see that after seeing the complete myeloid part, this was the myeloid part that we are talking about. Now, when we are talking about lymphoid lineage, which will lead to the formation of lymphocytes and natural killer cells, T lymphocyte and B lymphocyte. So that portion, that how B lymphocyte is formed, from bursa fabricus, how T lymphocyte is formed and goes to thymus and gets mature, how natural killer cell works, we will take a look when we'll be talking about, specifically about, you know, different immune responses. We will take that portion in that scenario. Let us focus ourselves after this understanding to a separate part that is called as structures of immunoglobulins or antibody structure. That is again a very important part that we should take first, and then perhaps we should talk about anything else. That what are the different types of antibodies that are present, how they are looking, how they are performing their work, What is primary response? What is secondary response? So we will be talking about that. Okay, so let me start with that particular saying. When we are talking about two terms, see, when we are talking about two terms, what terms I am talking about? I am talking about this particular nomenclature, what I am typing here, Ig and Ab. What is the difference? Ig is immunoglobulin, Ab is antibody. Both are same. Both are same as in terms of your composition, in terms of your structure. But the difference is antibody is secreted in response to an antigen and can bind, whereas the cell-bound antibody is called as immunoglobulin. So don't get confused. Don't think that there's a separate entity or something else we are talking about. So what are immunoglobulins? These are glycoproteins. What do you mean by glycoprotein? A protein chain which is associated by a carbohydrate moiety. It is called as glycoprotein. So these glycoprotein molecules, which are produced by plasma B cells in response to any kind of antigen or any kind of immunogen, that is called as immunoglobulin. So what is the function? What we are talking about here? Suppose an antigen has come, our body has sensed the antigen. Now B cells will start forming the antibodies. Now, when I say start forming the antibodies, what is happening? They will start synthesizing the glycoprotein molecules. And when they are synthesizing, they will synthesize in their cells. At that time, it is called as immunoglobulin. Once it is released from the cell and it is released in the blood from the cell, then those immunoglobulins which can attach to the antigen are called as antibodies. So that is the thing that you should have a very clear notion that how these things are going about. Then if you talk about the response or you say that these glycoproteins, when we are talking about these glycoproteins, whether these are charged or neutral, or what is the amount of protein that we are talking about in the serum. So if you take out the serum and you see the portion of this immunoglobulin, then you will see that the complete protein is lying in between. That means the charge is somewhat towards the neutral portion. They are not very highly charged species. So what they do? What is the function of immunoglobulin? It's very simple. They will bind to antigen. That is their primary function. They will bind to the antigen. Why they are binding to antigen? Because of that antigen only, these antibodies are released. So they will bind to the antigen, and after binding, they have many functions. They can activate the complement pathway, which we'll see. They can activate the macrophages. They can bind to the basophils. They can bind to the eosinophils. They can bind to each other in order to precipitate the antigen. So their functions are huge. So in order to see the structure, wherever we talk about antibody, we say that it's a Y-shaped structure. We draw a single line, but actually it appears in this manner. These bulges, what you are seeing, these are called as domains which are characteristic of immunoglobulin family. Like in my family, my forefathers, my grandfather, my father, we have a very common trait, which is the recognition part of my family. Like that, if a protein is belonging to an immunoglobulin family, then what is the characteristic? The characteristic is these domains, these loop kind of structures that are formed by proteinaceous molecule. If any protein is having this kind of structure, we categorize the protein under the same heading of immunoglobulin. So by looking, you can see this chain, the chain which is the lengthiest part is there, and there is a short chain which is present in this portion. Fine. Then this portion, what I am circling, this portion is called as variable region, and this portion, which is a stop, is called as constant region. The longest chain, long chain, is called as heavy chain, and the short chain is called as light chain. So a single antibody or a single immunoglobulin contains two heavy chains and two light chains. Now, when you say how these molecule or how these four chains are intact to give you a complete Y-shaped structure, then that these are intact because of these red colored lines what you are seeing. What are these lines? These lines are nothing but disulfide bonds. What are disulfide bonds? It's a protein. Protein will contain amino acid. Among the amino acid, they have cysteine also. Cysteine is an amino acid which contains SH thiol group. Now, two cysteine molecules will form the bond that is called as disulfide bond. So, wherever there are two cysteine residues, they are forming disulfide bond. And because of these disulfide bond, you see a loop kind of structure. And there are disulfide bonds in between the residues of variable chain and also between light and heavy chain. So there is interchain bonds and intrachain bonds, which causes the stabilization or complete formation of immunoglobulin. So that is the thing that you should be able to clear-cut understand, that what is actually we are talking about when we are talking about the disulfide bond residue. Then this portion, this multiple portion, what I'm showing you, this is actually hinge region. What this hinge region is doing? It's a Y-shaped structure. If I give you a blood sample of any patient, you will see the structure that from Y shape, sometimes the antibody can also form a T-shaped structure. T shape. What is happening in T shape? This complete Y is getting perpendicular to each other. So how this flexibility is achieved? This flexibility is achieved because of this hinge region, because of this hinge region, which is very important. Suppose the size of Y shape is limited. Now the antigen is of bigger size. In order to bind to a bigger size, this has to expand in both the direction. That expansion is property of the hinge region. That expansion is property of the hinge region. And that is why we say that this hinge region is of very importance if you want your antibody to specifically bind to the antigen. So I think I should be stopping here for your sake. Let me let itna let me